primary. From the shores of Lake Tahoe to the Placer and Sacramento suburbs to the Plumas National Forest, all the way to Death Valley. Tonight, the race for District 3. Top candidates answer questions that impact you. Inflation, Roe v. Wade, and more. Meet Democrat Dr. Kermit Jones, Republican Sacramento Sheriff Scott Jones, and Republican State Assembly Member Kevin Kiley. This is the KCRA 3 CapRadio Debate for Congress, District 3. Now, moderators Edie Lambert and CapRadio's Nicole Nixon.
And welcome to the debate among the three leading candidates in the 3rd Congressional District. We want to start with a quick look at the ground rules that all three of the candidates have agreed to. They will have a minute for the initial questions, a minute each. If there's any rebuttal or follow-up questions, that response will be 30 seconds. We can also tell you that we will have a quick round of yes or no questions because we're trying to cover as much ground as possible. And we want to thank our viewers for sending in some really great questions. We've incorporated as many of those as possible. And we want to also tell you that we did a random drawing as to the order of answers, and we will start with Assemblymember Kevin Kiley.
Last week, 19 children and 2 teachers were gunned down in an elementary school in Texas in another episode of gun violence. Why do you believe it is only in the United States these mass shootings happen so frequently, Assemblymember Kiley?
Well, good evening, and thank you very much to KCRA and CapRadio for hosting. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in. We have all seen how political failures and radical policies are ruining the quality of life in California, causing more people to leave our state every day. And what we are seeing right now is the same thing is happening to our country. We need a new direction. And as your congressman, I will fight to bring immediate change and get our country back on track. Now, my heart and prayers go out to the victims, the families, the communities, everyone affected by this unspeakable tragedy. But what we've seen over the last week is cynical politicians trying to make this a political issue rather than search for real solutions, the sort of solutions that I've proposed and supported in California, to make mental health services funds available to school sites, to have threat assessment teams at schools in order to detect early warning signs, as well as to have trained resource officers at every school. The fact is that we have a lot of solutions that we could work on to make our schools safer and make our communities safer, and that's what I plan to pursue as a member of Congress.
The question was, in 30 seconds or less, why is it that you think mass shootings happen in this country so frequently?
Well, again, it's very complicated, and I think a lot of the issues are the ones that I've just outlined that I've tried to address, issues related to mental health and a lot of other problems like broken families. And, you know, in this particular case, a lot of the issues that are frequently cited appear to have manifested themselves. But what I'm interested in working on is solutions to the problems that are underlying these horrific attacks so we can keep our schools safe and keep our communities safe.
Sheriff Scott Jones, the same question.
Well, good evening, and thank you for having this debate. Look, my heart is broken for Uvalde and the folks there. I have spent my entire adult life protecting people, especially children. And if I thought for 1 minute that there would be some one law or one thing that could prevent this or other shootings like this, I'd be the first to advocate for it, like I have for the last 12 years as sheriff. But to blame a gun is much like blaming a car when a drunk driver kills somebody. Sure, like a car operator, we can make sure that folks are licensed, that make sure that they have adequate training to operate a weapon. But in my experience, the new gun laws only affect the law-abiding and do little to dissuade criminals and those with violence in their hearts. It's easy to treat the symptoms. It's not as easy to treat the problems. And the problems are disassociated youth, broken family structures, mental illness, violent video games, and the effect that they have on the impressionable. We need to be able to, there is a school shooter profile. We need to be open about it and discuss it at the family and school levels and harden our schools.
And Dr. Kermit Jones, why is it that mass shootings happen in the U.S. so frequently?
My heart goes out to those families in Uvalde. As a father of little kids, I feel deeply affected by what's happened. And I think every single day afterward and with a lot of the other mass shootings that have happened, that I'm actually afraid, which I think a lot of families are. I think we don't have a lot of the tools that we could be giving to our law enforcement to actually keep people safer. We don't have the tools in the communities that we could be using. As a doctor who has seen a lot of people with mental health problems during the pandemic, we know that this is a serious issue. One of the things that I will sponsor in Congress once I get there is increasing funding for mental health services for people, for some of our troubled youth. You know, we've seen that a lot of these mass shootings, unfortunately, are committed within a certain age range. And so I think there are people that are becoming disaffected in our society, people that are having access to weapons that we have a constitutional right to have, but people that have serious problems and aren't getting the help are using those against their fellow Americans.
Our next question is talking about the price of things right now. As you know, we're paying record prices right now for gas. Everything is more expensive right now, from groceries to cars to houses. So what would you do in Congress to bring those prices down and make things more affordable for everyone in your district? And Sheriff Jones, we'll start with you.
Thank you. This economy is out of control, and there's not only nothing being done at the federal level, there's not even an acknowledgement at that level that there is anything wrong. This has been devastating to families. We need to do three things. First, we need to stop printing more money. The more money you put in circulation, it devalues the dollar and creates the inflation that we've seen. Second, we have to live with our means in the federal government. All of us have to live within a monthly budget. The federal government should be no different. They should stop spending $1 trillion here and $40 billion there. And third, we have to start paying down our national debt. It's not only a burden that we're shifting to the next generation, it is literally rendering us less able to defend ourselves if we were to experience a national emergency. And it's worth saying that we should be diligent to avoid new fees and taxes. I'm the only member or the only candidate on this stage that signs a taxpayer protection pledge that promises not to support any new taxes.
A 30-second follow-up on what exactly would you cut? $40 billion here and there is a lot of money.
It is, but it seems like couch money, couch cushion money to the federal government. Look, we have a budget. The federal government should have a budget, and that budget should be sacrosanct. We shouldn't just be able to decide that something is more important than our budget. If we add $40 billion somewhere that we believe is important as a country, then we need to cut $40 billion somewhere else. And let me tell you, there's a lot to cut in there. Bureaucracy is the enemy of democracy. We need to cut out the democracy, and we can find bureaucracy and find as much money as we need for the things that are truly important to this country.
Dr. Jones?
I 100% agree. I feel as if from the grocery store to the gas pump, we have a lot of families that are struggling. I have patients that are trying to decide between buying medications or buying gas. This is hitting the middle class all too hard. I feel that there are three things that the federal government can do, and this is what I would do when I serve in Congress. If it's not already passed, I would pass the America Competes Act. We need to bring our supply chains back home. They need to stop going through Asia and China and these other unstable countries. 70% of our chips are made overseas, you know, so if there's a problem in China, that affects us here. I mean, I do understand that we put a lot of money in the economy during COVID, but there's inflation in Europe, there's inflation in India. This isn't just an American problem, it's a supply chain problem. Second thing we need to do is we need to actually consider pausing the gas tax. You know, that's 75 to 80 cents at the state and federal level. Various Democrats and Republicans have advocated for that. That's money that needs to be in people's pockets and not in the coffers of the federal government.
Assemblymember Kiley, you've talked a lot about the gas tax.
Inflation is a huge tax on every American family brought to us by the Biden administration, and people are really feeling the pain, especially when it comes to these outrageous gas prices. The cause is no great mystery. It's this out-of-control spending. The federal government has run deficits of nearly $6 trillion over the last couple years. We're just printing money. And so the solution is pretty simple. It's to stop doing that, stop new spending, bring the federal budget to manageable size, and that includes eliminating waste, fraud, and abuse, which is absolutely rampant. Secondly, we need to roll back regulations, because that raises the cost of doing business, and those costs are passed on to consumers. Third, we need to make America energy independent, and that starts by completing the Keystone Pipeline. And fourth, we need to reactivate our workforce so small businesses can get staffed up, can have normal hours, and we can have a fully functioning economy again. I have been leading the fight to suspend the gas tax. I'm glad that Mr. Jones supports that proposal. It's why I'm endorsed by the Howard Jarvis Taxpayer Association, the PAC. That's the approach I'm going to take as a member of Congress to bring immediate change and immediate relief to American families.
And a 30-second follow-up for you as well, talking about if you're going to roll back regulations, a lot of those are designed to protect air and water and a lot of different things. So what regulations would you roll back?
Well, I mean, I can't name every single one because there are probably hundreds or thousands of them. We saw in the previous administration, they rolled back regulations every day, and it led to the greatest economy that we've ever had. I've seen here in California how the regulations that we have on every industry absolutely put a stranglehold on our economy. That's why people are leaving California in record numbers. That's why businesses are leaving California in record numbers. That's why we've had the highest unemployment rate, and it's a big reason we have the highest level of poverty. So rolling back regulations across the board is going to be a key priority for the next Congress.
California is in a severe multi-year drought, and it's only expected to get worse. Short of creating new water storage, which could take a decade or more, what should be done now to conserve water? This question goes to Dr. Jones first.
We have a very serious drought. It gets worse every single year. The snow caps are getting smaller. People are having difficulty accessing good resources to water. I think the federal government has a big role in this. We can provide tax incentives and tax breaks for people to collect their water. We can actually make businesses work more efficiently in terms of farms when they irrigate their fields. We can do that more effectively as well. I think we can focus on those things and make it so that we tie our drought and water policies to our forest policy. Many people know during the Calder fire and during the Dixie fire, when 1 million acres burn and the earth is scorched, that can no longer absorb the water that it could before. So unless we address our fire issue, unless we address our forest issue, we're also not going to be able to effectively address our drought issue as well.
Assemblyman Kiley.
Well, the governor is talking about new rationing and water cutback measures and restrictions, which I think is absolutely unacceptable. It is a clear sign of political failure. When you are told to take a shorter shower as water flows abundantly into the ocean, your government is broken. We have more than enough water that comes to us by the grace of God to supply our needs for indoor use, industry, and agriculture. We just haven't planned in the appropriate way in order to save water. I mean, our reservoirs may be running low. They were overflowing just a few years ago. So I proposed a constitutional amendment which would dedicate a fixed portion of the general fund every year to new water storage and water supply projects until we have a sustainable water supply so we can end this era of shorter showers and fallow fields. For the near term, there are plenty of things that we could do right here, right now, rather than asking Californians to alter their lifestyles in dramatic ways. I'd point, for example, to the proposal of a Democrat assembly member, Adam Gray, who pointed to other solutions such as rolling back regulations that divert water from productive use.
And Sheriff Scott Jones, what should we do to conserve water now?
So when I sat down with local water agencies, I learned a lot about water, that it's a very complex issue. You mentioned other than water retention, but it is worthwhile to talk about water retention because that is the key to our long-term future success in our water problem in California. For example, the Folsom Reservoir holds just under 1 million acre-feet of water, but because it's a multi-use reservoir and provides for flood control in the winter, about 1 million or more acre-feet of snowpack that falls in the Sierras is unable to be retained by Folsom and goes out mostly into the Pacific Ocean. So the site's reservoir will help that, but that's years off. If it takes 10 years from concept to turning a shovel to create new reservoirs, why aren't we talking about the next reservoir and the reservoir after that? We also have to come up with other alternative sources of retention, such as underground storage that is available in the Sacramento Basin, and other means of producing drinkable water, such as better technology for desalinization plants and other mechanisms to provide safe drinking water.
So we don't have a lot of time, and we want to cover as much ground as possible. For this next section, we're just looking for a very quick yes or no or very brief answer. And this is for the next four questions. So let's start with COVID rates, which are rising again in this region. Some counties may go back to COVID restrictions and mask mandates later this week. So do you support going to COVID restrictions when the rates are surging?
Absolutely not. In Placer County, we charted our own course. We trusted individuals to make their own decisions, and we did better with COVID outcomes than the state as a whole.
Sheriff?
Absolutely not. We first looked at deaths, then we looked at ventilator use, then we looked at hospitalizations, and then we somehow went to positivity rates. We know this Omicron variant, which demonstrates most of the new cases, has a hospitalization rate of vaccinated folks of zero and affects children even less. So absolutely not.
Dr. Jones?
I don't. My heart does go out to the people that have died of COVID and had their family members die, but we do have plenty of tools in the toolbox now between the COVID pill and the monoclonal antibodies so that people can stay safe and out of the hospital and we can keep our businesses open.
Abortion rights are a big issue, as you well know, right now as the Supreme Court appears to be taking the country in a new direction in the near future. Do you support overturning Roe v. Wade? And Sheriff, we'll start with you.
Well, it's important to remember that that's a draft decision that hasn't been finalized right. yet. But that decision, I think it's important to note, takes it away from the federal government and relegates it to the state. I am a believer in the founding fathers' constitutional model of this government, which means a very small and limited federal government and more power to the state. So any decisions that can be made more locally to the people, I think that's a wise move.
Do you support overturning Roe v. Wade?
I support overturning it as a federal mandate and relegating it to the states to decide. Yes.
All right. Dr. Jones?
I do not. I think we need to get big government out of people's lives, whether it's in the exam room, whether it's forcing COVID mandates, these other types of things. We need to put the ability to make these life-changing decisions with women and with their providers where
okay.
they belong.
And Assemblymember Kiley.
Well, that would be the appropriate decision from a constitutional point of view, and I am pro-life, and I will fight for pro-life policies.
Do you consider climate change to be an urgent threat, Dr. Kermit Jones?
I do. During the Calder fire last year, I took care of people, a woman who had to leave her house so quickly that with the fires coming on, that she had to leave all her medications at home. I took care of a man who suffered secondary burns on his feet when he was running over hot embers leaving his house. These fires are getting worse. They don't play politics. They affect you whether you're a Democrat or Republican or independent. We have to focus on those things that make us all stay safe,
okay.
regardless of
Thank you.
You know, your
Assemblyman
political
Kiley's climate change an urgent threat.
Well, the determining factor when it comes to these catastrophic wildfires is our overgrown forests. So climate change may, in some circumstances, be a factor, but it is the neglect on the part of our state and federal government that is the primary cause.
And Sheriff Jones.
All of that may be true, but in response to your question, you cannot argue with the facts that the climate is changing trends. In geological terms, it's a blink of an eye, but it's still something that we need to address. We can argue about the causes, we can politicize the causes, but we definitely need to address some of the outcomes and based on data and facts rather than emotion.
And this will be just a yes or no question. Do you believe that President Joe Biden was legitimately elected president in 2020? Assemblyman Kiley.
Well, it depends what you mean by legitimate. The Electoral College voted, and that's how we determine the powers of the presidency in our system. But even very left-leaning outlets like the Sacramento Bee editorial page have said that the election system was tarnished in 2020 because of a lot of things that went on. And I can give you a lot of examples of that. And so I do think that protecting our elections is an important priority. And what we've seen here in California is a very clear example of what happens when we have too much power concentrated in one party. You get abuses. And right now, we have one party that controls all the levers at both the state and federal level, and it's time to restore some balance.
Was Joe Biden legitimately elected president in 2020?
I've answered the question. It depends what you mean by legitimate.
Okay.
Okay. Sheriff Scott Jones.
Look, there's a political answer, but there's my honest answer. My honest answer is I don't know. It depends who you watch, which newscast you watch. But I know there's a lot of people that are confused enough and don't know the answer to that question that we should look into this. We can solve this election integrity problem, but there's not a political will to do it.
Dr. Kermit
Jones.
Yes,
I believe that the majority of Americans also believe that. I believe that the Supreme Court and multiple recounts have also demonstrated the same thing.
Okay, we're back to our longer format answers now. Looking at this new district, new lines here, it is a sprawling district, and you would be representing these urban areas, Roseville, Rockland, Folsom, and a lot of very rural communities throughout the Sierra. And healthcare is one of the issues where the needs are so different if you're rural or if you're urban, and that's just one of many examples. So how would you represent everyone in this really big district? And Assemblyman Kiley, we'll start with you.
Well, I grew up in this district. It's where I was born and raised. I went to local schools, and I've had the great privilege for the last several years of representing well over the majority of it in the California State Assembly. And the area that I represent now does have rural and suburban components to it as well. It's an amazing district. It has many of the most amazing parts of our state in it. And I am tremendously excited and would be honored to have the chance to represent it. When it comes to healthcare, yes, there are unique needs for different types of communities. I will tell you that in California, we have a Medi-Cal system that is absolutely failing. We have over a third of the state on it, and yet there's no evidence of improved healthcare outcomes. And when it comes to inflation, this is affecting healthcare as well. We're getting word now that there's going to be a huge spike in Obamacare premiums, perhaps by the end of the year, which is going to raise rates by well over 50%, premiums in some cases by well over 50%.
Sheriff Jones, how would you represent the diverse needs of this district?
Well, as pointed out, this is 10 counties, mostly rural. In this district, there are 12 hospitals, excluding Kaiser's, ranging in size from 17 beds to over 300 beds. Most of these hospitals serve rural communities, and they're always in danger of closing from financial reasons. The problem is that most of their patients are on Medi-Cal or subsidized exchange program policies. And compounding that problem is most of them come into emergency rooms rather than going to outpatient or other clinics. And the absence of telemedicine or effective telemedicine in these areas also play a part. What we need to do is create more jobs and job opportunities to elevate folks out of the Medi-Cal and exchange-based insurance programs and make sure they get employer-based private health insurance. It's better for the patient, it is better for the economy, and it's certainly better for continued access and availability of hospitals in these rural areas in this district.
Dr. Jones?
Yeah, 50% of this district is urban or suburban, 50% of this district is rural. And as was previously mentioned, we have serious issues with respect to people getting access to care. We have critical care hospitals that are on the verge of being in the red. We released the most comprehensive health care plan of anyone who's ever run for Congress, and that's because for the last 5 years, I've been taking care of people in this district in Northern California, seeing a lot of their issues. People that didn't have access to broadband weren't able to get telemedicine like they needed. That's why the infrastructure bill was good at bringing billions of dollars into our district for that. One of the things that we focus on in our health care plan is cost. As was mentioned earlier, cost is a huge part of inflation. We have some people who unfortunately can't afford their medications. We have a physician and healthcare provider shortage. When you look at the average number of providers in the country, we are lower than the average throughout our entire district. Our plan focuses on increasing the number of providers, lowering costs for patients, and focusing on getting care where they most want it in their homes.
So you brought up broadband. That is such a huge issue for these rural districts to have high quality, high speed broadband access. How would you get that out to a lot of these rural communities?
Yeah, my thought process has been that, you know, all government spending isn't bad. Spending that actually improves people's lives, gives them the types of services that they expect from their elected officials is what we need. People are tired of career politicians. They want people with real practical life experience that know what it's like to be on the ground and actually move things forward, not people that have decided that they want to put self before service. We're going to focus on implementing a lot of those infrastructure dollars to get that last mile of broadband to every single person in our district.
All right, thank you.
Yep.
We are going to take a quick break. When we come back, you'll hear some final thoughts from each of our three candidates.
Welcome back. It's time for final statements from our candidates. You will each have 1 minute. We'll start with Dr. Kermit Jones.
I want to thank KCRA for having this forum. I want to thank everyone at home for attending. I think it's simple as this. People are tired of politicians, especially career politicians. I'm not a career politician. I'm an American. I'm a Navy veteran that deployed to Iraq. I'm a father. I'm a doctor. I'm a husband. I'm someone with real life practical experience. And I'm also someone who is completely fed up with the partisan games and bickering. I think people want us to put our countries first. They want us to put our communities first. And I think if we don't do that, we are going to end up in a situation where our kids look back and ask us why. Why we didn't fight for them when it came to keeping them safe at school. Why we didn't fight for them when it came to the fires and health care and inflation. And unless we do that, we're not going to have an answer to that question. I am not a career politician. I'm someone who cares and loves our country. And I think if we work together and you want to elect a leader and not a partisan, then your vote belongs right here with me. And thank you for joining us today.
Sheriff Jones.
Well, it's hard to understand who to vote for with 1 minute answers and 60 second closing, but let me put it to you this way. You, the voters, are in charge of hiring for a very big job. It's Congress. And you may like one or more of the applicants for that job, but you have to hire the person that's best able to step into that job, the person who's most qualified. And like it or not, this is a Republican district. And among Assemblymember Kiley and myself, only I have a career of experience protecting people, of leading 3,000 women and men, of managing a $500 million budget, of making literal life and death decisions. Look, I'm not trying to make a life or a career out of Congress. I am trying to bring a lifetime of experience and a career to Congress. I'd encourage you to visit my website, scottjonesforcongress.com, especially my endorsements page, where I'm proud to have the support of Congressman Doug LaMalfa and Tom McClintock, who currently make up about 80% of this district, and I would appreciate your support and your vote as well. Thank you.
Assemblyman Kiley.
As your representative, I've authored some of the most groundbreaking legislation to pass in recent years on topics like freedom of speech, school choice, and public safety. I've also fought in every way I can against the radical failed policies that are causing California's decline, causing people to leave our state in record numbers, and that have given us $6 gasoline, the highest rate of poverty in the entire country, failing public schools, crumbling infrastructure, out-of-control homelessness, and surging crime. And right now, Joe Biden and Nancy Pelosi's Congress are trying to do the same thing to our country. So in this election, we face such a clear choice. Are we going to continue down the failed path of California, or are we going to return to the founding principles that have made America the greatest country in the world? As your congressman, I will get to work immediately to bring change, to tackle inflation, to secure the border, to stop the growth of government, to return power to local communities and their citizens. I believe California is worth fighting for. I believe this country is worth fighting for, and I would be honored to have your vote.
I would like to thank all three candidates. Sheriff Jones, you're right. It is not easy to answer these really intricate questions in 1 minute. So we appreciate all of you being here. And it's not easy for us to address the huge range of concerns that we know you have in a half hour debate. So we have a voter's guide at KCRA.com. All of these candidates have laid out their positions on their websites. We have that included on our website, KCRA.com, along with links to all of their websites.
Thanks again to our candidates for being here. Thanks to all of you viewers and listeners at home. Don't forget to cast your ballot. Election Day is just 1 week away on June 7th. Good night.